Hajo Holborn once said, "History gives answers only to those who know how to ask questions." It was only after I looked beyond my grade school textbook that I learned there were 8 U.S. presidents before George Washington, that the prevailing school of thought almost universally accepted by scholars long before the time of Columbus was that the world was round, that Napoleon was actually 3 inches taller than the average height for a male at that time. So much for that little man syndrome theory. In fact, the very word history comes from the Greek, meaning investigation. By its own definition, history requires a constant searching for answers. But in order to have answers, you must first have questions. I found my question in the New Mexican desert. This is that story.
So we're about 16 miles outside of a small town called Los Lunas, at the base of what the locals call Hidden Mountain, Montaña Oculto, or Mystery Mountain, which you can see here behind me. Our path will lead us right up that mountain, and on the top, on the other side, we should encounter the Decalogue Stone.
I have to admit, my journeys have led me to some pretty unique places, but this one is special. The Decalogue Stone contains a Paleo-Hebrew inscription of what some believe might possibly be the oldest surviving inscription of the Ten Commandments. What's most unusual is the location. It takes a 16-mile journey into the desert in rural New Mexico to find the stone, and it's not easy to find.
Now, it's not in the land where one would expect to find Hebrew inscriptions, and since it's on a multi-ton boulder, I don't think it could have been brought here. So it was produced here. For one thing, it's in the middle of nowhere. It's actually in a contested area on the border of the Isleta Indian Reservation and public land. There are no park rangers leading you around. There's no admission fee. It's just out there.
The Los Lunas Decalogue is this big slab of rock kind of at the entrance to a hilltop that might have had some ritual significance. The hilltop itself looks a lot like Masada, or it's kind of reminiscent of Masada being a hilltop fortress. It overlooks the Rio Puerco, so maybe that had more water in it back then, and maybe you could actually have some agriculture down there, and this was a refuge in case of attack. They would go up on top of the hill. On top of the hill, there are typical indigenous petroglyphs. So maybe there were settlements of non-Jewish indigenous people.
There is quite a bit of surrounding archaeology that one should consider with the Los Lunas Decalogue Stone. It's not just a stone. That was also the site of a fortress. And if you go up on top of the hill called Hidden Mountain, you'll see the lookout towers, you'll see the stones, so you have this whole fortress above the stone. And that was a significant site, as you can see, because there are inscriptions there as well in Hebrew. There are petroglyphs, there are the foundations of campsites. Curiously, in the same form that you find in Israel, that's been remarked upon by some Israeli archaeologists. So, like, you could go to Masada in Israel, where tourists generally go, to see the last stand of the Jews against the Romans. But you can also go to New Mexico, to Hidden Mountain, and possibly imagine that this was the last stand of a Jewish colony in the New World before it was wiped out or was blended with the Indians.
You know, there's also a bit of local folklore about this mountain, as some local Chuetas believe that there's a cave underneath this mountain that was enclosed by an earthquake, which now results in it resting at an incline. This cave is rumored to house the Ark of the Covenant, and according to local legend, it was brought here by Jews who wanted to build the new Temple of Jerusalem here in the New Mexican desert. And while that might be compelling, one doesn't have to look far to find a dozen other locations in the world where locals make similar claims. So I will maintain my position as a skeptic in that regard.
There are local crypto Jews who still say today they have a legend that it was engraved in lightning by the finger of God. Well, I don't care what your faith is, but if you have been there in front of it, you feel its enormous authority and authenticity.
So when was the stone discovered? Officially, the stone was discovered in 1933 by archaeologist Frank Hibben. According to Hibben, he was led there by a guide that had seen the stone as a boy in the 1880s. And upon Hibben's arrival, the stone was reported to have been covered in a thick layer of patination. Whether Hibben's story is true or not, many of the local Indians claim to have been aware of the stone as far back as 1800 and have commonly referred to it as the Cliff of Strange Writings.
It wasn't even discovered in the modern society for, you know, centuries went by until after the Lewis Clark expedition, the Americans, Caucasians, people with European ancestry came over and explored the rest of that area. Finally, it got explored and discovered, but no one could read it. Really, I don't think anybody spoke Paleo Hebrew. In fact, there is some difficulty in dating it by normal methods because one account mentions a Boy Scout troop would go out there and clean it with brushes. So that got rid of all the patina in the letters. You couldn't do that because they thought they were doing a favor by cleaning it out. But it's obvious it had been there a long time and was regarded as a holy site because you can see the Indian clan signs at that site that are right around it. And there's other inscriptions in the Paleo-Hebrew besides that one near that site.
Well, when you consider the question of how old the stone is, one of the difficulties is you can't date stone. You can't do a chemical test on a stone or look at it or study it or put it under a microscope and say this stone or this engraving is so-and-so years old or centuries old. You can perhaps consider the patina on the stone, the surface of the stone, but there's no way to directly date a stone, despite what you might have heard. So the question is, when you think of how old it is, you have to date it by the inscription itself or internally. You can't date it by the material on which the inscription survives.
I view it as going back to the time of King Solomon in that approximate period, and for several reasons. That's the type of language they used at that time. They had fleets that went all around the continents. Solomon had a fleet with King Hiram of Tyre. They went around the world. In fact, they had one fleet that only came back every third year or after a three-year journey, loaded with peacocks and apes and wildlife from other continents. So they were very wide-ranging at that time. The world knows that the Phoenician Empire had the monopolists of the ancient world in terms of transoceanic travel. I think it's important to point out that although in our modern world we use the term Israelite, in ancient times they would have used the term Phoenician. The Greeks were the people that gave the term Phoenician to the people that lived in the Levant. The Greek historians applied that term Phoenician to the whole coast that included Lebanon, Israel, Judah. It would have included all of those people. So when we talk about Israelite, the ancient societies would have used the term Phoenician. The Phoenicians didn't call themselves Phoenician ever. Even the people of Sidon would have called themselves Sidonians. So we know them by the names their enemies gave them. We have to keep that in mind. The same thing with Carthage, which was a descendant of the Phoenician Empire, which was Israelite dominant. And the language of Carthage was recognizably Hebrew, even though they developed an alternate script, which we call Punic. This is in the Paleo-Hebrew that existed before Judah went into captivity, before the house of Israel went into captivity. It was their common language when David and Solomon had the united tribes of Israel all under their rule. There is no way that in the modern world of the United States of America, anybody would have had the knowledge to inscribe the stones in Paleo-Hebrew from a language approximately 3,000 years ago that no one spoke, no one could read. Those few that understood Hebrew in early America didn't travel to New Mexico. And those few that understood Hebrew would not have understood the Paleo-Hebrew inscribed letters. They'd have used the more modern Hebrew.
Paleo-Hebrew, which is mostly used in the First Temple period back before 576 BC, but continued to be used in the Second Temple, mainly for coin script. In the First Jewish War, for example, they went back and used the old Hebrew script, kind of for nationalistic reasons, I think. But at the same time, also the Samaritans were using it, continued to use the old Hebrew script. They had a special version of it. But there's also several Greek letters mixed in. Cyrus Gordon, who had identified the Back Creek Stone as Hebrew, was of the view that it was probably a Samaritan inscription, maybe from the Byzantine period, like around the 500s or 600s AD. So I would lean toward one of those two centuries.
All the indications of the hidden mountain site, whether you look at the inscriptions, the alphabets, the Hebrew used, the petroglyphs, all lead to the same conclusion that this was made over 1,000 years ago, around 800, I would say.
So this is very exciting. Right here, resting at an angle, is the Decalogue Stone. And all around us are remnants of an ancient civilization. One can only imagine the true history of this area and who might have at even one point called this place home. Let's take a closer look at the actual stone.
Stephen Collins believes the stone dates back to the time of Solomon, which seems to make sense considering that was the script that was used during his reign. Dr. Yates believes the stone to date back to the period around the 9th century, and Dr. McCullough believes it to date to the 6th or 7th century. All three believe it to be pre-Columbian. Since there is no accurate way to date stone, if I'm going to make an educated guess, it's going to have to be based upon the inscription itself.
So here we are outside Los Lunas, New Mexico at the Decalogue Stone, and there's some very interesting things to note. This entire stone is an abridged version of the Ten Commandments from Exodus chapter 20, and it's not entirely Paleo-Hebrew. The first line, as you can see, was defaced about 10 years ago, it's 2006, but it picks up after that. Says Lo Tisha Elohim Acharim Al Panaya, which literally means you shall have no gods before me. It then picks up after that and it jumps around a little bit. There's some inconsistencies in the stone. So it says Mi Beit Avadim, which is the house of slavery, and then jumps back down to the next verse right here, which says Lo Ta Ashe Lecha Pesel, which means you shall not make for yourself any idols. And so this entire stone, like I said, is an abridged version of the Ten Commandments, but where it gets interesting is the actual text itself. There are several inconsistencies. Paleo-Hebrew was a variant of Phoenician. Some of the letters actually favor the traditional Phoenician text. For example, there's what could be an old Phoenician delet. The most likely scenario, because this is not a Paleo-Hebrew delet, is that this is actually a Greek delta, and it's not the only Greek letter in this stone. You have a Greek tau as opposed to a Hebrew tav. Over here, you have, instead of a Hebrew het, you have a Greek eta. You have a Greek zeta. So a handful of the letters here are Greek. And then on top of that, some of the letters are more Samaritan in their actual writing style. For example, the yod, which is the Y sound. Okay, there's one right there. There's one right there. The yod is actually not a Paleo-Hebrew yod. It's a Samaritan yod, which is actually flipped at an angle. You have also the sheen. There should be one right here. There's some other sheens in here. The sheen is actually a flat bottom sheen, which is the SH sound. And that is not the traditional way to write a sheen in Paleo-Hebrew. That is actually the Samaritan sheen. Then you have a lot of inconsistencies in the spelling. For example, Zakar here is misspelled. There's an extra Aleph. The entire grammatical structure, Zakar here meaning to remember, would be more of a Greek grammatical structure in the way that they use consonants and vowels. This is really done more in a Greek style than a Hebrew style in terms of the grammar, although most of the letters are Paleo-Hebrew letters. You have another misspelling here in the word panaya. You have right here, you have a kaf being used instead of a kuf. Now these letters sound the same in Hebrew, but these are different letters, and there is a correct way to spelling. Here, they've done an incorrect spelling in more than one place. What all of those inconsistencies tell me is whoever did this stone, whoever did this carving, was not using a transcription. They didn't come up here with one specific language and write something verbatim as they saw it. The person that carved this stone, and I think it really speaks more to the authenticity of the stone itself, was relying primarily on cultural experiences, on memory, on sound. That's why you can get the kaf and the kuf interchanged there. So what's the highest likelihood in terms of time frame? Well, the Greek influence would definitely date this post-Alexandrian. The fact that there's Samaritan influence is very significant for a couple of reasons. The Israelites use what's called a mezuzah on top of their doorpost. It's a very small thing, has a little scroll inside. But the Samaritans, instead of a traditional Jewish mezuzah, actually had Decalogue stones that they placed outside their places of worship, their places of gathering, and also homes. So here you see a very large Decalogue stone. So where would that place this time-wise? Well, Paleo-Hebrew was pretty much dead by the first century. And it really started dying off after the 5th century BC when Aramaic was introduced in the culture, except for the Samaritans. The Samaritans claim lineage through the lines of Ephraim and Manasseh as part of the northern kingdom that never really quite left into Assyria during the period of captivity. They adopted the Paleo-Hebrew alphabet and kept it long beyond what the rest of the Israelites did. And in fact, it eventually evolved into their own alphabet. And so that would explain why we see some Samaritan letters here. It would also explain why do we see Greek letters. It's likely, based on the grammatical structure being Greek, that whoever carved this stone was probably living in Byzantine Greece. And during that time, they thought with a Greek mindset, that was a primary language for them, the use of Paleo-Hebrew, which most of the stone is Paleo-Hebrew, was something that was largely used for religious purposes. It was a secondary language. So what we see here, with all these different influences, I would think this would probably be around 6th century CE. And the reason I think that, we know under the reign of Theodosius I in the late 4th century, Samaritans were known to live in Byzantine Greece, and they were prosperous ship owners that lived in Byzantine Greece that were Samaritans. They had entire fleets of ships at their disposal. Well, in the 6th century, when Justinian I took over, he initiated a massive persecution against the Samaritan people, and many who stayed lost their lives. They were executed, but many others hopped on those ships and they fled to new homes. And is it too hard to believe that they might have ended up somewhere here? Well, that's tough to say, but just based on the style of writing, I think that is a very real possibility, based on the inconsistencies, the misspellings, the grammatical structure, the fact that you have a little bit of Samaritan influence, a little bit of Greek influence, and what is otherwise is a predominantly Paleo-Hebrew Phoenician variant of text. And so I think that probably makes a pretty good time frame. Cyrus Gordon actually dated this. He's a Semitic expert to 6th to 8th century CE, so it kind of fits well within that time as well.
I found my question. But if I'm going to entertain the idea that others came here long before Columbus, it raises another question. Is that even possible?
The maps that we're familiar with, that we've been inculcated with our school day lives and beyond, have had a psychological effect in terms of us thinking that East and West never will meet, because the maps divide the world in terms of where the oceans are rather than where the land areas are. So the oceans are perceived as barriers, as dividing phenomena, whereas the land areas are unified. The oceans, on the other hand, actually were in many ways much more the avenues of connection than were the continental areas. The ships that sailed those oceans were much more efficient. You could transport goods much more efficiently, much cheaply, much more safely than you could on land. You could take dozens of times more goods on a ship than you could on, say, a mule caravan or on wagons. And the costs of land transport were very much greater than sea transport. Therefore, people were, where they were proximate to the seas, they were sea-oriented, and they did most of their traveling and transport by water. The resistance to this idea of transoceanic contacts before Columbus is based on supposition that watercraft and navigational methods, techniques of sailing and so forth, were not sufficiently developed until the end of the Middle Ages or the early Renaissance to allow humans to have crossed the vast oceans and to reach the other side. That is based on suppositions that are very Eurocentric. They don't take into account the fact that in other parts of the world, watercraft and sailing techniques and rigs were very much better developed than in Europe at the time of the Columbian voyages. In classical times and even earlier, voyages were being made. It was routine, for example, to cross the Indian Ocean a couple of thousand miles out of sight of land from the mouth of the Red Sea down to southern India by Greek and other sailors of the period. This is a longer distance than it takes to get across the Atlantic at the narrowest point between Africa and South America. So if they could do it in that direction, they could do it in the other direction, and likely did.
They had the means to do it. They would have obviously come through the Mediterranean Sea, across the Atlantic. And it's interesting to point out that in the Atlantic, the distance from West Africa to Brazil is less than the distance from Jerusalem to Gibraltar. This was not that big a leap.
The distance across the Atlantic from the western bulge of Africa to the eastern bulge of Brazil is about 1,750 miles. That's less than the length of the Mediterranean Sea, which was routinely sailed, of course, between Egypt and Rome and the Phoenician region in the Levant and the Spain. So it was not a daunting distance. But if you want to get technical, you can take a look at the northern Atlantic, in which if a sailor from, let's say, Norway were to go out to the Shetland Islands and the Faroe Islands and then on to Iceland and on to Greenland and then on to the Americas, that distance, the maximum water gap would be about 240 miles, which means you would never be more than 120 miles away from land, and you would be only 70 miles out of sight of land in the entire transatlantic crossing. So that, again, is not a daunting distance, to say the least.
We are very ethnocentric in our historical viewpoints through the Greco-Roman perspective. We know about the Carthaginians through the Romans. Everything is taught from a Greco-Roman perspective, and we assume nobody could have done anything unless the Greeks and Romans did it first. The Israelite empires, the Phoenicians, the Carthaginians, were maritime. They were the penultimate middlemen as merchants because they knitted together all the diverse places around the world that wanted to trade, and only they had the trading routes. But I believe they were far more widespread around the world than people give them credit to. The world was far more diffusionist. Solomon had the means, he had the opportunity, and the desire. So he had the finances to support transoceanic exploration efforts. He had the desire in scientific curiosity to learn all there was to learn within the framework of the context of his times. He had to use sailing ships. The Phoenicians and others too, the Egyptians and others, were much more ingenious than we give them credit for. Ancient man in general was. They could navigate by the stars, obviously, we know that. But if you're keeping to a schedule and a course heading, you need some way to find your way in cloudy or rainy skies. They had essentially compasses. They could put lodestones in a basin and even give it a somewhat of a gyroscopic balancing by putting the basin within a basin so the rocking of the ocean swells would be minimized. But you could put a lodestone in there on a float so it would align itself with true north, and that way you could keep a course heading.
They had techniques of sailing and navigational methods that allowed them to feel pretty confident no matter where they went that they could find their way back to where they came from. They had techniques of discovering new islands. In Southeast Asia, for example, for millennia, travel had been undertaken in sailing canoes. thousands of miles. Of course, the settling of the Pacific Islands, the Polynesian Islands and Melanesian Islands had been going on for 1,500 or more, well, actually quite a bit much more years than just a millennium. They had been going out to remote islands as far back in time as 1,500 or in some cases maybe even earlier, before the time of Christ. The exploration for islands was new islands, uninhabited islands in the Polynesian region was basically institutionalized. They were not daunted by enormous distances or long time voyages that might have taken them months, even years in some cases. The prevailing winds form a series of gyres, circulating systems that run around each of the major ocean basins. So there's a circulating system of winds, which also generates a circulating system of currents. And you have conveyor belts, in essence, which are natural and almost automatic avenues of transport. Columbus used the North Atlantic gyre, for instance. So these circulating gyres, one in the North Atlantic, one in the South Atlantic, one in the North Pacific, one in the South Pacific, one in the Southern Indian Ocean, these provide ready-made avenues for maritime transit. In fact, it's the case that ships, if they got caught in one of these gyres, they automatically were carried across the oceans. And we have numerous instances of drift voyages, unintentional drift voyages that that show that it was inevitable in early times even that the other side of the sea would have been discovered and reached. These impulses, these skills, these watercraft, adequate watercraft were available not just 1,000 years ago, not just 2,000 years ago, but probably as much as 2 or 3,000 years prior to that, maybe even more. We're still learning about the history and the development of watercraft, of sailing rigs, and techniques of navigation, but we can be certain that they go back millennia, much earlier than formerly supposed.
So obviously, the ability to travel the distance was there, and the lack of a magnetic compass isn't the be-all to end-all if you're navigating by the stars. But if transoceanic travel had occurred, wouldn't there be more evidence?
The Israelites over here had not just the Decalogue tablet, but they have left inscriptions in other locations. There's what's called the Bat Creek Stone that was found in the American Southeast. Jewish Second Temple coins were found in Kentucky and Tennessee. There are gravestones and artifacts and inscriptions from both the Phoenician, but more recently the Carthaginian period. The Carthaginians coins have been found throughout the American Southeast.
Again, if you find a menorah mound, you kind of say, well, it must be an accident. But if you find a menorah mound that's Hopewell down the road from a Hopewell mound with a Hebrew inscription in it, and next state over, two states over from a Hebrew inscription in another earthwork, not Hopewellian probably, but still a burial mound, maybe of the same general period, then you have to start saying, well, maybe this really is a menorah. There may have actually been some cultural contact. In Ohio, there are these extensive Hopewell earthworks that were pre-Columbian, now thought to be principally 200 BC to 500 AD, thereabouts. It turns out this map was of great interest to Thomas Jefferson, who had very eclectic interests. And it appears that the reason he was interested in it was that the structure on the inside here looks like a nine-branched candelabrum, with the center, the ninth one, standing a little bit higher than the others. It turns out that's the Hanukkah menorah, the menorah that Jews use to celebrate Hanukkah, which celebrates a miracle that's supposed to have taken place where an oil lamp burned for 8 days, even though it only had enough oil for 1 day. And oddly, the enclosure, the top of the enclosure looks very much like an oil lamp. It would take thousands of person hours to build this earthwork. It would take a good community, a year to everyone working full time to build this earthwork. And the thing is supposedly 2,000 feet on the side, the outer enclosure. So this is a huge earthwork. The walls are reportedly like 10 feet high and 30 feet wide at the base, but it would have taken the whole community to do it. It wasn't just five people in their spare time. But one of the earlier things was a lot more interesting is the Newark Decalogue stone. Like the Los Lunas stone, it's a decalogue. It was found in a burial mound among the Newark Hopewell earthworks, so it's presumably Hopewellian, which is 200 BC to 500 AD, more or less. So that would be the most precise date you can put on it. It's probably pre-500 AD, because that's pretty much when the mound building stopped, at least that phase of mound building. And then the inscription itself is runs over every side of the stone. There's an inscription that starts up here and runs down the top, and there's a little bit of inscription in here, and then it runs around the back. There's the whole back is inscribed. The sides of the platform are inscribed. It turns out that the inscription was quickly identified as being, the letters are Hebrew, but they're a funny sans serif stick letter Hebrew instead of the usual printed Hebrew that you would see in the 19th century. It's more like a lot of Second Temple informal inscriptions in Israel, but the language is Hebrew, and it clearly has a condensed version of the Ten Commandments on it. And then the figure on the front there is identified over his head in Hebrew letters as Moshe. So this would be Moses. So in 1880, thereabouts, Congress actually appropriated money to the Smithsonian to go out and explore the mounds and show that when they're scientifically explored, you don't find any inscribed tablets. The ironic thing is that that mound survey turned up the Bat Creek stone. One of the mounds in Tennessee turned out to be have a little inscribed tablet, and it was a very simple tablet. I have a replica of it here that's this is metal, but this is the actual size of the stone. And it has some funny letters on it, which the Smithsonian published like this, and it was found in historical Cherokee territory. It had been Cherokee as recently as 1819. So Cyrus Thomas, who was leading the study, was actually an entomologist, insect scientist, declared that the letters were obviously Cherokee without actually giving a translation. And so for 80 years, they actually published it as part of the proof that there were no Old World inscriptions in the New World. And then 80 years later, in 1970, Cyrus Gordon, who's a Semitic language scholar, turned it upside down and said, well, it's actually Paleo-Hebrew from, looks like the coin script of the first century AD. And not all the letters are clear, but it looks like it says Lehud. There's a string Yehud, which means Judea. And there's another letter in front, which is the Lamed, which would make it Lehud, or for Judea. There's a broken letter at the end, which might be a Mem, so that would be Lehudim, which means for the Jews. So there's a pretty recognizable Hebrew string of letters written in the old Hebrew alphabet following the coin script of the First Jewish War. Even people who cited the mound survey as being the authoritative proof that there were no Old World inscriptions, based on its ironclad body of data, scientifically collected, one piece of the data actually is an Old World inscription. And clearly, Cyrus Thomas, the head of that project, was incompetent to identify Hebrew, or to identify ancient alphabets. If he's got a Hebrew inscription in his own hand, it could have bit him in the nose and didn't identify it. He's not really looking for Old World inscriptions. He was looking not to find them. And one way to get historical dates is through carbon-14 dating. Unfortunately, you can't date stone, so you can't directly date the Bat Creek stone or the Decalogue stone or the Los Lunas stone. What you have to do is find something that's associated with it, something wood or charcoal that's associated with it, and date that. I was able to get a carbon-14 date run on some wooden ear spools that were found in the same burial as the Bat Creek stone. These are definitely part of the same burial. And that turned out to be somewhere between 32 AD and 769 AD is the 95% confidence interval. So that encompasses the First Jewish War, which was the best guess of what the alphabet is from the style of the letters. So that definitely rules out anything post-Columbian. In fact, it even rules out the Vikings being no later than 769 AD.
The time frame of the First Jewish War is interesting because the Jewish historian Josephus acknowledges that they had a decent naval presence, but perhaps it's his account of the defeat of the second century Bar Kokhba revolt, or Third Jewish War, that's even more compelling, where Josephus states, "The Hebrews fled across the sea to Epirus Occidentalis, meaning the extreme limit of the West, a land unknown to them before." What's more interesting, both Cherokee experts I'm aware of, one of which I've personally spoken with at the Cherokee Museum where the Bat Creek Stone is kept, don't seem to think the script is Cherokee at all, but rather Hebrew. Even more recently, a sample of wood taken from the burial of the Newark Decalogue stone was carbon dated and showed a range of 70 to 230 AD. Although based on the style of script, these might be two different groups of people entirely.
Whether the Bat Creek people had any knowledge of the Newark Decalogue people is, there's no really tight connection between the scripts, and then Los Lunas is, could be a totally independent group of people also.
Dr. Fell and others have documented Phoenician, Israelite, Hebrew. They're dialects of the same Semitic language. They have found inscriptions for them in South America, particularly in the area of Brazil, which is known as an iron ore producing nation. What is the Hebrew word for iron? Barzel? And the consonants are B-R-Z-L. Is there a nation in Latin America with iron ore deposits that has the continents B-R-Z-L in it? Yes, Brazil. It still bears the Hebrew name for iron.
The evidence for transoceanic travel in early times is abundant. Most people who have studied this subject, have been interested in this subject, have first been struck by certain kinds of cultural commonalities between various aspects of culture in the Old World and in the New World. Mostly they've been struck by what we call arbitrary traits, that is to say, traits whose probability is very, very low that they were ever developed or invented in the first place. The most arbitrary things of all, of course, are vocabulary in language. We do find linguistic ties, but we find some very striking commonalities, for example, between some of the Afro-Asiatic languages of the Middle East and North Africa on the one hand, and the Uto-Aztecan language of the New World on the other hand. Arbitrary things in culture include, though, not just language, but religious ideas in some cases, cosmological ideas, the idea of different colors assigned to the different cardinal directions. Now, that's pretty arbitrary. Why would the white be east and the south red or whatever? But you find that system, sometimes with the identical colors, being repeated on both sides of the Pacific. The calendar system of Mesoamerica, an extremely elaborate, sophisticated system of calculating time, and it's of the same genre as the calendar systems of the Old World, which are found in South Asia, in East Asia, and to a lesser extent in the southwestern Asian regions. This calendar system is not only similar in general characteristics and operation, but it has series of deities and animals and other attributes. There are several in-order sequences of a number of animals, for example, assigned to days or other time measurements that are identical on the two sides of the ocean. That's a very good case of an arbitrary cultural phenomenon. There's no particular reason for assigning a large cat to the month of October, for example, or whatever it might be in those specific systems. But culture cannot absolutely be proved to be of common historical origin, no matter how similar it is. You can always say, well, if somebody could come up with that idea in one place, they could do the same thing someplace else. So we need something more to give us concrete indication that there actually were contacts amongst the societies of the Old and New Worlds. Not all of them, of course, but certain ones. And this, so we look also to biological evidence. And the biological evidence that has been accumulated in recent years has been absolutely astounding. And what we have, among other things, is perhaps a score or two score of cultivated plants from one hemisphere, of which archaeological remains in pre-Columbian times have been found in the other hemisphere in indisputable archaeological contexts. These cultivated plants cannot leap oceans on their own. They are incapable in most cases of even surviving without human care. Now you would expect that natural plants would be much more capable of spreading to the other side of the ocean than would cultivated plants. But cultivated plants are much more numerous. That suggests human carriage because not natural dispersal. Because as I said, if natural plants survive better in the wild than the cultivated plants, they would have been the ones that were more numerous on the other side. These include maize, custard apple, which is a fruit, a tropical American fruit, pineapple. Images of the sunflower are found in Indian Hindu temple art. Datura, which is a Jimson weed, it's a psychotropic weed that might have been of some medicinal or mystical interest. In addition, there is evidence, historical evidence, linguistic evidence of quite a large number, as a matter of fact, maybe 100 or more other cultivated plants and biological entities that were shared on both sides of the oceans before the time of Columbus, and again, which could not have leaped those oceans on their own.
When I started on this path, it became apparent early on that the body of evidence was growing and extending well beyond any one inscription and included artifacts from all over the New World, like the Newark Keystone, another Hebrew inscription, coins found in Kentucky, one identified as a coin of Claudius II from 268, and another of Maximinus II from around 300, 800 Hebrew stones in Puerto Rico, artifacts with Assyrian writings that describe Assyrian deities in Mesoamerica, the ruins of the Olmecs, a civilization that virtually appeared overnight as a fully developed and advanced society with advanced celestial navigation tools and formulas, and sculptures that contain African features and Egyptian attire depicting the Battle of Kadesh with Hittite charioteers, blades found in Guatemala resembling the Shang Dynasty, the Fuente Magna Stone in Lake Titicaca, which has Proto-Sumerian symbols and writing, an Argentinian stone of the commandments. When Jesuit Nicolas Deltsu arrived in South America in 1587, he encountered locals that bore Jewish names and were circumcised, quote, just like their ancestors. Then you have Indian legends of Quetzalcoatl, the white-bearded culture bringer from overseas, and inscriptions in what is known as Quetzalcoatl's cave, the nearby Tucson artifacts, where swords and crosses were unearthed, vases, pottery, and coins from the Sung Dynasty found in Oregon. Even records from the Sung Dynasty claim that Chinese explorers reached the West Coast 70 years before Columbus reached the East. Celtic Ogam inscriptions in New Hampshire and Maine, inscriptions that speak of ships sailing from Phoenicia, a granite discovered in Massachusetts containing Punic and Iberian alphabets that references Hanno the Navigator, an actual historical figure that, according to Greek writings, navigated the Atlantic in 500 BC. A stone discovered in Long Island in 1888 that contained Egyptian and Libyan script and described an expedition sent from Egypt. The Johnson-Bradner Stone, the Grave Creek Stone, the Davenport Stone, and the Kensington Runestone, a runic inscription that many believe is proof the Vikings made it inland. Then, in 1998, a scientific breakthrough occurred that would shake the world of genetics to its very core. And this breakthrough was found in the DNA of certain Native American tribes.
Critical to understanding and proving these things is the genetic record. And if you look at the genetic record of the Americas, it's pretty clear that the geneticists and the ones that we have put in charge of telling the story of the peopling of Americas have really botched it. The stories that you read in our textbooks today are like fairy tales. So all Native Americans are supposed to have come across the Bering Land Bridge chasing woolly mammoths. They didn't realize they were immigrating. And of course, they all had haplogroup A, haplogroup B, haplogroup C, haplogroup D, okay? They probably all verified that they were haplogroup A and B and C and D from each other, I'm sure. But that's, of course, a fiction. And it doesn't even begin to tell the true story of the peopling of the Americas. And that began to be obvious early on in the genetic age in 1998 when they discovered an extra haplogroup among American Indians. And that was haplogroup X. Well, no one wanted to believe it, but and there was a great flurry of paper in the academic journals until finally it was proved beyond shadow of doubt, yes, some American Indians have haplogroup X. The worst thing about finding this was that haplogroup X did not come from Siberia or Mongolia. In fact, haplogroup X could not be found today in Siberia or Mongolia. So this was a great embarrassment to big science. There was something more to the story of the Americas, and it revolved around haplogroup X. So then, subsequently, after it kind of sank in that haplogroup X wouldn't just go away of its own volition, they began to study where haplogroup X was found. And one of the places it was found in great abundance was the American Southwest, maybe suggesting even that not all the so-called Indians were Indians in the American Southwest. There were other peoples here, because the center of diffusion for haplogroup X is Palestine, or the hills of Galilee. Now, you can put that together with the archaeological evidence, with the linguistic evidence. And so there are theories that maybe the Phoenicians, who also came from that area and among whose descendants haplogroup X is very strong, today it's the Druze people who preserve the greatest diversity of haplogroup X. Maybe it was the Phoenicians, you know, who brought it here, even though Phoenicians, just like Jews, are not supposed to be in the American desert. But, you know, you have to follow the facts. And the facts were saying that haplogroup X was an important part of the rest of the story of the peopling of the Americas. It's pretty clear that, for the most part, the American Indians have had their history written for them. And that, of course, has rightly enraged them, and they fought against it, so much to the point that now they're pretty much suspicious of anybody who gets a summer grant to come work on the reservation and write their history. You know, they're not really perfectly cooperative with that, because they see where that leads. No people should have their history written for them, you know, whether it's written by the Smithsonian or by John Harvard University or Nature magazine.
With mounting evidence, experts in every related field now have strong proponents of pre-Columbian migration. But of all the experts, perhaps the most interesting was Columbus himself. Columbus had great interest in the writings of those that speculated existence of a new world, and according to his own journals, he wanted to find the lost tribes of Israel. In his first voyage across the Atlantic, he even brought a Hebrew interpreter along for the expedition. Now the next question is, where exactly did Columbus think he was going? That he needed a Hebrew interpreter?
Why are these precious relics of our past dismissed? Why are they ignored? Why so much passion? Why so much passion goes into overturning the record, or burying it, or proving it wrong? This question has often bedeviled me, and you know, it's hard for me to understand how someone could turn a blind eye and a blind ear to all this evidence.
I think there's been an unfortunate tendency to follow the, I guess what I call the fallacy of the singleton. I mean, you ask archaeologists, what about Hebrew inscription X. Well, they say, well, if it's authentic, there must be others, and there are no other authentic inscriptions, so the one you're talking about must be a fake. And once it's a fake, then when the next one comes up, it's the only one also. The second one would be the only genuine old world inscription if it were authentic, and you can't just have one, so the second one must be a fake too. And the third one's a fake, and the fourth one's a fake, and the fifth one's a fake. And those fakes get forgotten about, and people don't even remember they existed because they were fakes. So there might be 10 promising old world inscriptions, each of which has been proven a fake by the fact that it's the only one.
What happens in many cases in these findings is the scientific method isn't really applied, and the rationale that is employed is very much a circular argument. For example, in the tomb of Ramesses II, 2nd millennium BC Pharaoh, they found in the thorax cavity tobacco leaves and a cigarette beetle from the New World in his tomb. We see the same thing in South American pre-Columbian burials, where we see intestinal parasites of the Old World that somehow were excavated in the tombs of pre-Columbian burials here in the New World. So obviously these things cannot cross an ocean by themselves. How do they get here? Well, what they eventually came up to, because it puzzled them, they had no answer for that, was, well, it must be contaminated. You see, if they find an artifact or something that proves a point that they already hold, a position they already hold, they'll wave it around and say, here's the evidence, see, this is certifiable proof. But when they see something that might speak to interhemispheric interactions before Columbus, they'll instantly dismiss it as contaminated because we know that nobody came here before Columbus. So essentially what they're saying is, because we know that nobody came here before Columbus, any proof we find that somebody came here before Columbus must be contaminated because we know nobody could have came here before Columbus. And within the confines of that circular argument, you can't present any evidence.
And so, you know, they use a kind of circular thinking. It can't be there, and so it's not there, but it is there. And it's not there in splendid isolation either. It's part of a site. You know, one of the objections is, oh, they weren't found as part of an archaeological dig. They're found by amateurs. The Los Lunas stone has been known to be there as long as there have been people there. Or people will say, it's an unexplained fluke, you know, which is a little bit of a cop-out, I think. So why is this? You know, why should it, every single one, unfailingly, one after another, have to be fake, have to be false, have to be forged, have to be wrong? You know, can so many people have everything so wrong? The answer to the question is not just a simple, oh, this is obfuscation, or this is the limits of our education. That's not an adequate answer to why history is buried like this, why history is damned like this. And the answer goes back into American history and the origins of the Smithsonian.
In the 19th century, the Smithsonian, which must have had quite a bit of influence at that time, issued an edict that scholars, college professors, teachers, etc., would teach only that Columbus discovered America and that there were no pre-Columbian expeditions or discoveries that predated him, and that people's tenure or positions were at risk if they taught anything else. And that's not my opinion. That's in my books where I cite the source material that quotes the Smithsonian effort on that.
Well, in the 19th century, there was a lot of conflicting political implications. I mean, we were expanding and taking over all this Indian territory, and there was a big issue of who had been there first and what claim who had to the land. And people were generally pretty racist by today's standards. There were all kinds of racial theories, one way or the other, about whether the Indians were racially entitled to anything. It was a political issue in terms of land entitlement.
No one wants to conflict with evolution's dogmas in the academic world. And according to the academic world, there couldn't have been high-tech civilizations in the ancient past.
The racist sentiment towards Indians in the 19th century is well documented, culminating in a government policy known as Indian removal, Government officials in Washington quickly realized that the natives presented a real threat to westward expansion or manifest destiny, and it was in their best interest to paint them as inferior and barbaric. John Wesley Powell, head of the Smithsonian Bureau of American Ethnology, once said, "In setting forth the evolution of barbarism to civilization, it becomes necessary to confine the exposition to one great stock of people, the Aryan race." This view became institutionalized by the Smithsonian and was shared by one of his closest allies, George Foster Peabody. Powell eventually hired Cyrus Thomas to lead the mound surveys. The mounds were plundered and much of the evidence was destroyed, while other findings were buried in the catacombs of the Smithsonian, never again to see the light of day.
So why is that? I think it's more than just that they're protecting their own little preserves, because imagine if the Los Lunas stone is genuine. Okay, I'm trying to stretch your imagination. I know it's genuine, but imagine if it is accepted as genuine. Well, that means that everything that they've done is wrong. Everything you think you know about the history of North America is wrong. You know, facts are facts, and inferences are inferences, and expert opinions are expert opinions. If you've seen the stone, you're absolutely sure. If you are, moreover, a scholar and have talked to other scholars, especially those who are qualified to say, you are even more sure about the Los Lunas stone, that it is possibly the most valuable, the most precious monument of our cultural patrimony in our past.
I will say that it is probably the most unappreciated artifact from the ancient world anywhere in North America, for sure, because our elites don't want us to know about pre-Columbian artifacts, so it hasn't been protected. There should be a huge interpretive center there. It should be protected. It's on Indian trust land, the last I knew, but someone sneaked onto that land and they defaced it. They erased some of the letters on there here in recent years. I saw it before the defacement. But I do think that it is being ignored deliberately.
It's a big problem. But, and you know, how it will be dealt with, it will not be dealt with until the story of America changes. Because as long as the story of America is Christopher Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492 and there were nothing but ignorant savages here before, as long as that is the official story of the Americas, nothing is going to happen.
My journey is complete. As with any good foray into history, more questions were developed than answered. And as I journey once more into the wilderness, I realize we may never know the full story, but perhaps that's the point. In the meantime, all we can do is speculate about the lives of those that sought new opportunities. Perhaps in a new world.
Once you visit the Los Lunas stone, you will never forget it.